Java, Sumatra, Celebes, Bali, Lombok, Flores, Timor. Little Dutch school children used to have these place names hammered into their heads. Now only a grandfather could rattle them off. Sulawesi, Sumbawa, the Emerald Belt, Indonesia, the Dutch Indies, 300 volcanoes on the largest archipelago on Earth, 300 different languages and dialects, as old as the world, and for centuries the richest source of pepper and spices, and therefore the promised land for the Portuguese, English, French, and the Dutch. In 1590, Amsterdam had only just started its impetuous growth under the oppression of the Spaniards and the Portuguese. In those days, small vessels would deliver the goods straight to the warehouses on the very first canals. Those were the days when the Baltic trade provided Amsterdam's main livelihood, and when the Dutch were the preeminent shipping agents in European waters. By 1594, in that same Amsterdam, rumors were already circulating about the fantastic wealth of the Far Indies, and a spy had even been sent to Lisbon to gather secret information concerning the East Indian trade and all that was involved. The information forthcoming certainly kindled the spirit of enterprise within the hearts of the Amsterdam merchants, not to mention an appetite for expansion and wealth. And in the Warmoestraat, that hotbed of initiative, many an anticipated chicken was counted before it was hatched.
Hier moet het ongeveer geweest zijn.
This is where it must have been, in the Warmoestraat in Amsterdam, at number 170. That nine enterprising merchants got together in Martin Spill's wine house in the year 1594. They were there not only to sample the wine, but to commit 290,000 hard Dutch guilders in cash, thus founding the Company from Afar. So in Martin Spill's wine house, the plans were made for the first long voyage from the Netherlands to the far-off Indies. In Amsterdam Harbor, ships were rigged and equipped for that very first muster trip, which was to take them halfway around the world. Four ships, the Hollandia, the Mauritius, the Amsterdam, and a Duifkin, the little pigeon. It was to become one of the most disastrous expeditions ever undertaken from the Netherlands. Rickety second-hand ships, poor equipment, and a rowdy and disorderly crew of 240 men in all. Even before reaching the first rallying point at the Cape Verde Islands, the crew had already been decimated by disease and infighting. The Amsterdam merchants had put one Cornelis de Houtman in charge of the expedition, but they hadn't entrusted him with the rank of admiral, as they doubted whether he was of that caliber.
Goodbye.
For the time being, de Houtman could only swallow his impatience, while for days and weeks on end, regular logging only indicated a snail's pace of 2.5 miles per hour.
Thank you.
Cornelis de Houtman didn't exactly inspire respect from his crew. And to the higher ranks also, he was known as a vain and witless braggart, greedy and untrustworthy. The man with whom he was continuously at odds was Gerrit van Beuningen. Van Beuningen was an ambitious and forceful bully, with his own personal views about de Houtman's procrastinating attitude. He was convinced that he himself would be much better at settling matters on board. The two men were a daggers drawn. Van Beuningen, all contempt. De Houtman, a bundle of pent-up but as yet powerless rage. The situation on board deteriorated daily, whilst inch by inch, the ships were creeping back across the ocean, now in the direction of Madagascar. Brawls and fights would break out at the merest trifle, not infrequently at the instigation of a firebrand by the name of Cornelis Laertsen, who of all things had been employed as a provost to maintain law and order, but instead turned out to be a cantankerous grouse who even incited the men to mutiny. In these situations, de Houtman preferred to stand aside, which didn't improve matters. Finally, when Cornelis Laertsen, in a fit of rage, threatened to stab the trumpeter to death, it was van Beuningen who gave the order to have him overpowered and locked in irons. A few days later, he was put ashore on Madagascar, and that was the last that anyone had ever heard of him. At Madagascar, it took the expedition 5 months to recover from their agonies. Sick and miserable, they were stuck in a bay, which soon earned the grim nickname of Dutch Cemetery, for the members of the crew were dying from scurvy and exhaustion at the rate of 2 a day. The strife between de Houtman and van Beuningen was brought to a head when the captain of the Hollandia himself died of scurvy, upon which van Beuningen took the opportunity of claiming the right to be installed as the new captain. Already at the former captain's funeral, van Beuningen symbolically but quite openly made his intentions clear by calmly and unscrupulously taking the captain's hat from the dead body. There, in the Bay of Madagascar, van Beuningen took charge of the ship on his own authority, forcing the crew to swear allegiance to him. His first decree during the period of his ruthless command was to have all sick and useless men put ashore, unarmed and practically naked. Some of them were rescued by the crews of the other ships before the natives could cudgel them to death. That put the lid on it. Van Beuningen was put in irons and sentenced to stay there until the end of the voyage as a dishonorable, God-forsaken and forsworn rogue and firebrand. In these same irons, where sun nor moon draws near, van Beuningen sat for 8 months until he found himself back in his homeland without ever having caught so much as a glimpse of the Indies. Yet some people seemed to believe in him, for less than a year later, he was made captain of a ship to Japan. En route, somewhere near Chile, he met his death from a native's poisoned arrow. Miserable, exhausted, and sick, the small fleet embarked upon the final part of the voyage. And finally, the promised land came in sight, Bantam. The relief they felt can only be imagined. Whether de Houtman was going to get far with all the beads and mirrors stacked up in the ship's holds remained to be seen.
Op 22 juni...
On June 24th, 1596, 1 year and 3 months after having left the Netherlands, three of the four ships landed here on the coast of Bantam. But Cornelis de Houtman bided his time. Small Javanese ships moored alongside, and the first people to come aboard turned out to be Portuguese. A heavy blow for the Dutch, who hadn't expected to find their enemies here. A few days later, on the 1st of July, Cornelis de Houtman himself went ashore, here, near this Chinese temple. Bantam, with its hinterland of pepper gardens, proved to be a hornet's nest of intrigue, with everybody contradicting and opposing everybody else, so that de Houtman had a tough job finding out who could be trusted in order to get the spice trade off to a good start. Today, the village of Bantam dozes half asleep. But in those days, it was swarming with international activity. The bay was full of ships from innumerable Asian nations. You may think that Cornelis de Houtman was a pretty lucky man. On the contrary, the price for spice turned out to be very high. The main reason for this was the fact that de Houtman proved to be an inveterate procrastinator. Forever waiting for better harvests or lower prices, he let many a supply of pepper and cloves go to waste. And so the frustrated crew members more or less started to buy in the goods off their own bat. Also, they soon discovered that some Javanese would mix in small pebbles with the pepper to give it even more weight. Close to the spot where Cornelis de Houtman first set foot on Indonesian soil, the Dutch later built a fortress, Fort Speelwijk. Some ruins remain, overgrown with the vegetation which thrives above all else in fertile Indonesia. Thanks to the thorough descriptions of early Dutch settlers, with their painfully conscientious attention to detail, the exact locations of these ruins can still be traced. After 5 months and a lot of bickering, the Dutch had managed to negotiate together one shipload, mainly pepper, and anchor was weighed. The intention was to head for the Malaccas, but they'd hardly left when trouble struck again. On Madura, a fierce attack by the inhabitants had to be repulsed at the cost of many lives. It was decided that these inhospitable regions should be abandoned at once, and that they should set course for that island paradise, Bali. Of course, the captains of the 17th century didn't know the ins and outs of Buddhism, Hinduism, or ancestor worship on islands like Bali. The descriptions in their journals are therefore no more than simple observations. The natives of the island are common heathens. They pour forth their prayers in their temples, before entering which they are obliged to remove their footwear. They have a habit of offering food by way of sacrifice, placing it in front of the temple. They worship idols, which are cut out in stone, and on their temples they may build as many as 9 roofs piled one above the other. Sometimes the young women come to perform dances for these idols. At the gruesome end of these extraordinary dances, the men seem to pierce themselves with creases. I do not know what death presages for these people, for when one of their men have died, we have seen the women wail and weep in very loud voices, and the wife follow her husband into death at the burning stake. In those days, Java was already the center of inter-Asian trade. Ships would come in from Malacca, India, Siam, China, and the Moluccas. Everything revolved around the spices. One of the spices for which the Dutch traveled to the Indies was cloves. Cloves did not exist anywhere else in the world. They were exclusive to a few Moluccan islands. So whoever had the Moluccas had the monopoly as well. That is why the Dutch fought for so many years, to possess the Moluccas and with them the cloves.
Alle dompi lama lama, tinggal mama deng sudara. Apa tuang balik, tong di Ambon tunggu alik. Sio lama lawangi. Kalau nona sio nona sempat lente, tempo apa tuang balik, makumpulin katong.
When will you return? We are feeling so alone. Beautiful Amboina is waiting for you. When will you return? The homecoming of what was left of de Houtman's fleet, with a mere 87 survivors, instantly caused a mad rush for Indonesia. A great number of hastily improvised independent companies were organized, the main target being the Moluccas. Even before 1600, the first Dutch ships landed on Amboina Hitu, and in 1600, a small group, led by Stephen van der Hagen and assisted by the natives, built and garrisoned a fortress here. It was baptized Castle from Afar after the company. The Amboinese were quite keen to help with the construction, as they saw in the Dutch a welcome opportunity to free themselves from the greedy Portuguese. But this castle from afar was not enough. In order to get a tight grip on the situation, the Dutch had at least to conquer the town of Amboina as well. Meanwhile, in Holland, the United Dutch East India Company, the VOC, had been founded. Stephen van der Hagen got the immediate order to attack the town of Amboina. In this town, situated right on the coast, was a Portuguese fortress with over 30 cannon and a garrison of 600 men. The entire garrison, however, cleared off like a shot, as soon as the Dutch made their appearance, enthusiastically cheered by the Amboinese. The Dutch stated that they may have been protected by the hand of God. Van der Hagen, who had been hailed as a liberator, converted the Portuguese fortress to a solid Dutch one and named it Castle Victory. Now only a small part of Castle Victory remains, and the water gate facing the sea looks badly battered. Even the formerly proud emblem of the VOC is now no more than a halved and forlorn remnant. The ruins are in a way symbolic of the grim battle waged here for years by the Dutch, before they could begin to get a hold on the islands. They fought the Portuguese, the English, and the Moluccan people themselves. In the name of cloves, a lot of blood has been shed on these distant lands. The clove tree looks something like a birch and bears no fruit until it is 12 years old. The clove tree originally grew in the wild on a few northern islands. But during the Portuguese rule, the growth of this costly spice was cultivated and small orchards came into existence where people started to grow and tend their own trees. When the calyx starts to wilt, it is picked and dried, either over a smoldering fire or in the sun, after which the dark brown, tack-shaped clove remains. This drying is still done on every piece of available ground which gets the full sun. In many cases, this means on the public highway, which runs right across the kampong, the village. Were you to look for the numerous fortifications built by the Dutch in those days to keep their countless enemies at bay, you'd hardly find more than the odd overgrown ruin. Here, more than anywhere else, both the turmoil of battle and the power of nature have reclaimed those once so staunch and solid structures. In Hila, for instance, on the island of Amboina, they built this blockhouse, Amsterdam, 350 years ago. Only some weathered walls are still standing, dramatically, almost surrealistically held in the stranglehold of enormous banyan trees, the seeds of which have fallen onto the walls, while the fantastic aerial roots reach down like tentacles seeking the fertile ground. Even the great Portuguese Saint Francis Xavier personally visited Amboina to propagate the Catholic faith. But once the Portuguese Jesuits had been chased away, the Dutch did not hesitate to import their own Protestant ministers to build churches and teach the natives. And so long ago, the Amboinese children were taught so-called native history, not of their own forefathers, but of the Vikings, the Romans, and especially the Dutch, and geography, which made them more familiar with the topography of Amsterdam or Flushing than with their own Jakarta or Semarang. The struggle for the possession of cloves was initially centered on the northern Moluccas, where they were mainly grown. But even after the Spaniards had been expelled from Ternate, these northern islands were ever hard to control, with the smuggling trade flourishing on a large scale. And so the Dutch took the drastic measure of totally eradicating the entire clove culture in the north and concentrating it on Amboina. For Amboina happened to be the easiest place to defend, with its many fortifications, like this blockhouse Haarlem. The Amboinese themselves were forced to partake in these eradication missions, which are still grimly remembered as Hongai raids. They had to make their boats, or korakoras, available, and provide the oarsmen as well. With these boats, great numbers of them were forced to join in under Dutch command, to scour the northern islands, to travel inland, and chop and burn down every single clove tree plus anything else that might grow. Little by little, the Amboinese developed a deep attachment to the Company, as the United Dutch East India Company was generally referred to. Everywhere else, however, opposition constantly raised its head and was subsequently struck down relentlessly. In 1817, this great Fort Duurstede on the island of Saparua was the scene of one of the most violent revolts against the Dutch rule. An uprising led by the celebrated Moluccan freedom fighter, Patimura. Patimura led his rebels in an all-out attack on Fort Duurstede. Many of his men had acquired their skills serving in the Dutch army. They had sufficient weapons at their disposal and superior numbers. As a result, there were quite a few casualties, among them the resident of the fortress, Van den Berg, and his family, who were all massacred, with the exception of one little son, Jan. This little boy was left for dead, but survived his injuries and was smuggled into the jungle by a slave. Some years later, this little Jan, after many wanderings, returned to Holland, where he asked and was granted permission to call himself Van den Berg of Saparua, a surname still in existence in Holland. It was not easy to overpower the rebel Patimura, and the revolt extended to other islands before it could be suppressed. Patimura was taken to Amboina and imprisoned in Fort Victory. The land gate of Fort Victory has since been rebuilt and now carries the coat of arms of Patimura, who at his execution respectfully bade farewell to his judges, shouting in a steady voice, "Selamat tinggal, tuan tuan." In other words, "Gentlemen, I wish you a pleasant survival."
Kalau nona sing parlente, tempo apa datang mangente.
When will you return? Why should you stay in Holland? Whether you can make a living or not, come back anyway to Amboina. When will you return? We here on Amboina, we are waiting for you. There have always been hawks and doves, and also in the Netherlands of the 17th century, minds were divided about the way things should be handled in the far-off Indies, with kid gloves and diplomacy, or with an iron fist. The hard line found its origins, for the main part, in the little town of Hoorn, where you can still find the statue of the man who by 1618 had already become known as Iron Jan. Jan Pieterszoon Koen. Diametrically opposed to him were the advocates of a conciliatory policy. One of them was a warm intercessor for the Indonesian culture and separate identity of the Indonesian people, the Governor General of the day, Laurens Real. The responsibility for what was to happen next lay with the VOC's board of directors, the 17 gentlemen who had a stomachful of revolts, loss of money, and discomfiture. They voted for the hard line. So Koen it was to be. Real was sacked, and Iron Jan Pieterszoon Koen was appointed Governor General of the Indies. Koen has been both vilified and admired by historians. Whatever can be said about him, he certainly knew Indonesia like the back of his hand. As early as 1607, he had been there as an assistant merchant, and in 1614, he had been appointed trade manager of Bantam and Jakarta. It was at that time that he wrote his first discourse about trade in Indonesia, in which he was already clearly stating his ideas on colonization and the demonstration of power. He didn't have a high opinion of the natives and favored the bend-or-break approach. He wanted a strong army and harsh measures to put an end to the insidious plotting and scheming. Beat them into obedience, was his advice. Koen wanted to get out of Bantam and to start afresh somewhere else. He chose Jakarta, which in those days was only a small settlement. He bought a piece of ground there from the local sultan in order to build a trading post and a modest fortress. The English already had a small trading post in Jakarta. Koen immediately razed it to the ground. This meant instant war. The English showed up with a strong fleet, and the Dutch had to withdraw into the fortress. Kuhn himself went to the Moluccas to seek reinforcements. Months later, Jan Pieterszoon Kuhn returned from the Moluccas with reinforcements. And to his utter amazement, the Dutch were still holding the fort. He bombarded and conquered the settlement of Jacatra and founded a new town here, which he had wanted to name after his place of birth, New Horn. But the 17 gentlemen refused permission and called it Batavia. Surrounding the old fortress, a new structure was built, the castle, which effectively protected the wheeling and dealing in the new town. Batavia, the Queen of the East, and the first genuine colonial city. Kuhn wanted to populate his young town with people from the Netherlands, preferably not with half-baked criminals or prostitutes, but with decent and respectable folk, who were to have the status of free citizens. For the time being, however, he had to cope with a lack of people, especially European women, with the result that extensive cohabitation with native women took place. Marriage was out, unless these women were willing to adopt the Christian faith. Soon trading ships were coming and going to the new Batavia, where Bandanese, Chinese, and even Japanese came to settle. The town was expanding to the Dutch pattern of canals and drawbridges, with typically Dutch houses and streets, which were given the same names as well-known streets in Amsterdam. There is not much left of the numerous Dutch warehouses that were built around the castle. Only the so-called West Side warehouses are still in reasonable condition and are being kept in good repair by the Indonesian authorities. They serve as a maritime museum now. For quite some time, the emotions provoked by the painful struggle for independence in 1948 disturbed the relationship between Indonesia and Holland. But the remnants of the Dutch no longer stand as symbols of blood and resentment. The iconoclasm has quieted down. Time has brought a more philosophical view of the colonial past and the old ingrained cultural ties. The tangible reminders of that colonial past and of the Dutch settlers are now carefully restored and maintained. Also part of the splendid palace of the Sunan of Solo in the middle of Java has now been made into a museum. And this beautiful Dutch carriage can be seen here, still in perfect condition and cherished as a pusaka, or sacred legacy. In 1724, this carriage was donated by the VOC to the Sunan of Solo, who, right from the very beginning, had given evidence of being kindly disposed towards the Dutch, a rare attitude among the native princes. Because of the endless journey, the gales and the sometimes very poor equipment, the ships often sustained not inconsiderable damage. A central place for patching and repairs was therefore something of a priority in the Emerald Belt. And so the entire island of Onrust, unrest, was turned into a permanent center of activity, completely built up with wharves, little houses, material sheds, and a Dutch windmill, all surrounded by a wall, and defended by a battery of cannons. Inside this wall, the European workmen lived in total isolation and were consequently pretty discontented. Just twice a year, they were allowed off the island for 3 days to squander their pay in Batavia. The only one on the island who lived like a king was the boss of unrest. He was well paid for supervising all the activities and was not averse to making a little extra on the side by fiddling the books. But like his house, of which only a few pillar stumps remain, the boss of unrest himself didn't last forever either. Thousands of miles east of Batavia, we find the small island group of Banda, Bandanera, Lontor, Pulau Ai, Pulau Run, and the volcano Gunung Api. Banda is a fertile island of mace and nutmeg, where Javanese, Malaccans, and Chinese come to sell their goods and remain there for 2 or 3 months. On such occasions, they first buy themselves a woman to provide for their comfort and convenience. When they sail off again, they let her go free until another year when they come again. Here too, the natives are mostly heathens, following the Mohammedan faith, to which they have a great devotion. Because of the abundance of mace and nutmeg, the Banda Islands fell victim in a grim and barbaric way to Ayan Yan's hard line. Previously, Admiral Peter Verhoef had already had orders to conquer the islands and build fortresses there. But at the very start of his negotiations, Verhoef had been ambushed and killed. The first fortress built by the Dutch appeared on Bandanera, Fort Nassau, which for a long time stood there to no purpose, as the entire population had fled from the island, so that the much-desired harvests of mace and nutmeg couldn't possibly materialize. In all records of those days, the inhabitants of the Banda Islands were booked as utterly treacherous and totally unreliable. And of course, it was none other than Jan Peterson Koen who decided to settle these affairs once and for all. With the help of 2,000 armed men, he tackled the islands, taking the entire population prisoner and removing them all together. All villages were destroyed and burned to the ground. At least 40 village chiefs were tortured, hung, drawn, and quartered. It was one of the darkest pages in Dutch colonial history. Under the protection of formidable fortresses like Hollandia, towns began to develop, like Middelburg. The United Dutch East India Company had definitely started its career as a colonial power. The land was divided into plots, each containing about 50 nutmeg trees and a fixed number of souls. These were imported slaves who tended the nutmeg trees under the guidance of Dutch plot holders. This forced culture lasted till well into the 19th century. In a blood and thunder fashion, Koen had laid the foundation for a colonial empire which was kept up with dogged perseverance by his successors for 350 years. The Governor General headed the so-called Council of the Indies, an important board which managed all Dutch business matters and the whole of Asia from its headquarters in Batavia. The founding of the town of Batavia meant that a small kampong of a few hundred people grew into an enormous metropolis of more than 6.5 million today. Jakarta, capital of the Indonesian Republic. The old town hall is still there, the former Dutch town hall, now a museum. The atmosphere of the past still lingers amongst the furniture and the relics. Regents have sat here, managers, governors, hardliners, but also men of diplomacy and tact, men of consideration and understanding, and also the advocates of violent solutions. Decisions were made here, right ones and wrong ones, just ones and ruthless ones, by men who made history and by others who have been forgotten. Until the very last man abandoned his seat and left it empty.